Peer-to-peer urbanism, a new discipline that ties together two very important concepts. A new type of urbanism, which includes traditional urbanism and the latest research that we have on how to recreate human-scale urbanism in the world. Since about the 1920s, and especially after the end of the Second World War, we have been creating cities that are not fit for human habitation by imposing a certain geometry that is anti-human and certainly antisocial. And this geometry by itself has destroyed a community, has destroyed social relations, has destroyed families. Now, I speak as a mathematician because I studied geometry, and architects just look at images and they don't know how to analyze images. So I'm coming with a lot of analysis of urban form. So what does this have to do with commons? Well, we go back and my friends all over the world, we extract geometries that work to create living cities, that work to enhance life, biological life and also social life. And those are to be found in traditional settlements and traditional towns and in pieces of cities that have worked for hundreds and thousands of years. So we extract these rules for the first time in lists and that we can present, and we publish them openly. So here's where the peer-to-peer aspect comes in. These rules are published openly so that anyone around the world can access these rules. And at the same time, they can interact with us and they can go and contribute. So it becomes a peer-to-peer method for a repository of rules that help one to construct a living city. And the living city that one constructs from these rules is very different from the city, from the new parts of the city that we see all over the world today, that governments with a stubborn insistence go in and build at great expense inhuman settlements. At the same time that we publish these rules openly on the internet, we invite people to come in and use these as open source and to contribute to them and to modify them according to the local needs. Now, these rules are the DNA that will create, for example, an urban space that works well in a district of Berlin. And then you take the same rules, which are the DNA for creating urban spaces, and you apply them to some place in Fiji, and that will generate an urban space that works very well. Now, the adaptability to the local conditions will make the end result totally different. The rules are the same, but the end result is totally adaptive to the local situation. Now, contrast this with what is done today. A city hires a famous architect to build a glass and steel skyscraper. The same skyscraper in Berlin, and then the government of Dubai hires the same architect, and he or she builds the same skyscraper in Dubai. This is totally non-adaptive. It is a stubborn non-adaptivity. So we are fighting against that. Now, true to the philosophy, all of this material is available freely, and furthermore, it's available in English, soon to be in Spanish, Portuguese, and Italian, and in other languages. We have a proposal for a social housing, a specific proposal of how to build social housing. Social housing is not done by building cubes out of concrete and forcing poor people to move there, because these are community-destroying geometries. We have our own proposal of how to build social housing using the participation of the residents. That is tapping, and here I can speak to the Brazilian members who attend, tapping the self-construction of the people who already build their own houses slightly illegally, peripherally, tapping that and combining with the peer-to-peer urbanism rules that we have developed, drawing in the resources of certain specialized